Hey, gentlemen. Appreciate your bearing with us this evening. Meeting starts as follows. Adequate notice of this November the 12th, 2015 meeting has been provided in accordance with the Open Public Meetings Act by posting written notice and agenda of this meeting on the bulletin board in the Municipal Building, 1000 Route 10, Township of Hanover, and by hand delivering, mailing, or faxing such notice and agenda to the following newspapers: Morris County's Daily Record, The Star Ledger, Hanover Eagle, and by filing same with the Township Clerk. Have a roll call.
Committeeman Gallagher.
Here.
Committeeman Faramasta.
Here.
Committeeman Bruno.
Here.
Committeeman Capola.
Here.
And Mayor Francioli.
Here.
Five members in attendance, sir.
Okay, Mr. Administrator, at this point, we'll have the posting of the colors, please.
We'd like to welcome the Hanover Township Veterans Alliance for the posting of the colors and leading us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Please stand.
Raise your hand.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Ready? Two. Recover.
Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen. Very smart. Very smart. Ladies and gentlemen, at this time, it's an honor for this township committee to be able to make a presentation of the awards of the following organizations. And that's comprising of our Veterans Alliance, which is our Marine Corps, of our Marine Corps, both living and deceased, distinguished service for both peace and war. I'd like to make a few remarks before we make the presentation, and it's appropriate that we do this. We know that Veterans Day yesterday throughout our great nation was celebrated this past Wednesday, and throughout our nation, on bases throughout the world, embassies throughout the world, we also celebrated Veterans Day, and we celebrated the service that the ladies and gentlemen here with us today have given us here in the United States. Needless to say, on that day, we honor all of those who served in uniform and who stood between tyranny and freedom in defense of the United States Constitution, and all of us here, citizens of the United States. Those who met the enemies of our nation wherever they were, in Europe, in Africa, Pacific, the Middle East, Asia. On this day, cities and towns throughout America stood tall for all the men and women here and in the past, and we thank them for their courage and their service as a grateful nation. We look on this committee of elected officials, and when doing so, if it were not for you, we wouldn't be sitting here today, and I wouldn't be speaking here today with the freedom that I have to express my opinion and the opinions of these gentlemen. We speak freely and democratically. We act for the good of all of our town and our nation. Sadly, I would comment at this time that the sacrifices you have made on our behalf is not nearly responded to with the benefits of health care, economic support, jobs and job opportunities that others are enjoying. Today, many are out to right that wrong. We know that Home Depot is part of a organization that is assisting in that change. Angela Davis was to be here tonight. I don't know if Angela was able to be make it. I don't see her representing the Home Depot folks. Home Depot is doing much in the way of grants to build housing for our vets. And I know that they're part of a chain of stores, not just Home Depot, but Lowe's and other similar stores that are recognizing our vets with jobs and discount opportunities in the stores themselves, and doing their part to try and right some of the wrongs over time. We thank all of you here in this room who have served. You've done much for us, and we stand with you here in Hanover, and we salute all the members of the Marine Corps League, the Slattery American Legion, Division American Legion, our Veterans of Foreign Wars, and all umbrellaed under our Hanover Veterans Alliance. And gentlemen, Township Committee, if you please rise. We salute you today, tonight. So thank you all for all you've done for us. Appreciate it. Okay. Thank you, gentlemen. George, do you have some comments?
I have a couple of comments I'd like to make. First of all, I think it was really great for this committee to want to take this opportunity one day late, but not forgotten. If our meeting was on the 11th, we'd be doing it on the 11th. I have been with these gentlemen quite a bit lately. Bob Beck, Commandant Marine Corps League, Brian Pillion with the American Legion, Ron with the VFW. And as part of the Veterans Alliance, I think it's a wonderful group and a wonderful thing to be honoring you all this evening. You know, we also got Home Depot that's coming down. It's going to do work for it. Bob Beck is working with that, and they're going to be doing a veterans home for 11 vets. The funny thing on that whole thing is the stuff with Home Depot began with a piece of paper. A little note that my wife got from Bill Witowski and Joanne. If you'd stand up, please. Please stand up. They gave a little piece of paper saying that the Home Depot would like to do something for the vets. They were actually talking a vet at the time. Instead, when we started talking with Bob and the committee, as we met down at the American Legion, they figured they could do something for the veterans home in Dover, which would help out 11 veterans, which I think is wonderful. And they do everything. If anybody got to see the work they did for the Cosgrove facility up at Picatinny, you'll get to know that they do all the work, the labor, the material, everything. Home Depot is very dedicated to the vets. So for the 2 years, thank you for that little piece of paper you gave my wife, which got the ball rolling. Thank you. I also have with me a letter from Congressman Frelinghuysen. Dear Mr. Capone, George, enclosed, which I invited the congressman to come here this evening to present flags flown over the Capitol building. Enclosed, please find 3 American flags and the certificates which note that the flags have been flown over the United States Capitol for Flight Officer Robert E. Gillick, Post 5351 of the Veterans of Foreign War, Whippanon Post 155 of the American Legion, Lance Corporal R.J. Slattery Detachment 206 of the Marine Corps League, at my request. I am pleased to know that you and each of these organizations will treasure these flags and all they represent to freedom-loving people around the world. It is important that we continue to recognize the men and women in uniform who have and continue to sacrifice for our nation. And it was interesting today to see the President put the Congressional Medal of Honor on a captain who really did quite a service for our country. He's one of few living recipients of the Medal of Honor. I saw it on the news today, so I thought that was wonderful. But to each of the organizations, I'm proud to be affiliated with you. I know that the Freeholders recognizes Monday night. I thought that was also very nice. So with that, I say thank you. God bless all of you guys for all you do, and I really appreciate it. I know the committee was more than grateful and happy to be honoring you all this evening. So with that.
Okay, George, this one first is
you going to carry that?
It's heavy, George.
Let me go around.
Brian. Brian, would you step forward on that?
George, bring it around the front. Okay. Yeah. Here you go, George.
George.
He's in charge. These are for each of the organizations, the Hanover Township Committee to Whippin' on Post 155, the American Legion. In grateful recognition of your service in peacetime and war, and your devotion to serving God, the United States, and the Hanover Township community. And it's for today, actually for November 11th.
Okay, the next recipient, Ron Engel. And bullet post number 5351.
There it is.
That's George.
Hi. Good. Thank you. Pops, I appreciate it. Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you.
I don't know.
I
You go up with him for an hour or so, and he puts you through your paces, and finds out where they can still fly airplanes. Oh, that was wonderful. That was very nice. Oh, yeah. You have that.
Yeah.
I'm there.
George, thanks.
George, very nice. Okay. All right. All right, gentlemen, at this time, to continue the meeting, I'd like to open to the public for any items not appearing on the agenda. Motion to open.
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, once again, the floor is open at the podium. Giving us your name and address for the record. We will be imposing our four-minute rule as usual. And Barbara, how are you?
Hi. Barbara Ames, Cove Lane Road. Just a brief update on the freeholder meeting of last night. You may have heard, I saw John today, so he knows a little bit, perhaps. The freeholder board did on Monday night approve an amended solar build-out, which is smaller than it originally was contemplated. Three county sites, I think five school board, and that leaves, I guess, a couple of municipal sites. Hanover is not one of them. I think you understand that. So that makes me personally happy. I hope you're feeling the same way. But we think that the input we had into that process raised a lot of questions and issues that they subsequently looked into. It will ensure a project that is financially sound going forward, but that will actually make some money back.
Mm-hmm.
So that's not that. We also commented on the budget. The budget process is starting immediately at the county level. And some of us made comments about keeping the budget flat. You'll know that Kathy DiFilippo is kind of not with us on that one. She's kind of waffling, I'm not sure. And
not with us in the sense that he anticipates a budget increase?
Well, they're not. She's not sure they can keep it flat. They've got a lot of expenses, yada, yada. And so I think that the citizens who participate probably didn't like what they heard. And I'm just thinking, I don't know whether you, as a body that doesn't seem to have a lot of difficulty doing that, whether you would, just a question, whether you would feel comfortable writing a letter to the freeholder board urging them to do that, as you have done over how many ever years you could document that. So I think we'll be pushing for that, and also for a zero-based budgeting process, which we asked about, and they do not do that kind of a budget to put their budget together. And we also pushed a little bit to get the public involved in the process a little bit more, too. So that's kind of what we're pushing on the budget front. Third thing, today I had a meeting with John Bonanni and a counsel who's going to be, they're going to be hiring a special counsel to look into the whole issue of regional planning. Mm-hmm. I met with two attorneys, John Bonanni, and two county employees, Dina Leary, head of planning, and Jen Carpentieri, her head of human services, and talking a lot about the North Jersey Regional Plan, which, as you know, the board did reject, and exactly what that means for the county. So I think I know that I'm very happy that they are actually going to have some legal counsel look a little bit deeper into what that really means for Morris County. And I think that's a good thing, and we'll keep you updated as that moves forward. So.
Thank you, Warren.
Thank you. Yeah, this is for not on the agenda, right? Is that what you said? Yeah, okay.
Yeah, if there are other items on the agenda as we go through them, we'll open to the public for now.
Jim Neidhart, 3414 Appleton Way, Whippany. Yeah. I'd like to ask you if there's any information that you can give that's for public dissemination on the River Park Business Center. I know there's a lot of legal issues that you can't discuss.
River Park? Yeah.
But I just want to know if there's any update. The last I heard is that they canceled the last meeting and postponed the planning meeting to November 24th.
Yeah.
And I just want to know if there's anything that new to the status degree, or to, what's going to happen next.
To the degree I can comment, I have counsel with me, so he'll slap my hand, and he'll probably comment. But to the degree I can comment, the township position has been immovable from the original court. The court-approved settlement, I'll use the right language, court-approved settlement of some 10 or 11 years ago. Jim, as you might recall, that settlement called for now allowing her back then, flex buildings on the site. Flex buildings, for everybody's edification, are 80% warehousing, 20% office. And in conjunction with the flex buildings, that settlement included a donation of 22 acres above the dam to Hanover Township for open space and for attachment, in my opinion, to Central Park and the growth of Central Park. And in conjunction, in midway point of that property, there was agreement to two buildings of some 120-odd units, which would be senior citizen-directed buildings, much on the level of the ones on Boulevard Road.
Would that be on the opposite side of the river, closest to Eden Lane?
That would be above the dam, but closest to, I'm going to say, the northern side of the property, okay. Rosin Road.
Because there were two things that I just saw on the plans.
Well, there's the treatment plant that you're talking about closest to Eden Lane is the one you should be concerned with. But I don't know that we had any density on the treatment plant site in that settlement.
No, I don't believe we do.
Yeah, I don't think it was any. There has been chatter about the fact that there would be a bridge built over the Whippany River at the Edenwood intersection.
Boxwood Court.
Not so.
Right.
Not so. And I say that with a high degree of confidence. The cost of which a bridge like that would be absolutely prohibitive. There's also been chatter about the fact that 1,000 COA units are going to go in there. Not so. Having said that, Council, yeah. You have any comments?
Very accurate. The mayor spent so much time on this going back to 2004, but, you know, as everyone knows,
been deja vu, Jim.
The site's been inactive since the early 1980s. And what I can tell you right now is there's a lot of things that are, you know, publicly known that are in the courts. One is the settlement, as the mayor mentioned. The town, in accordance with that settlement he described, adopted an ordinance because it was really the obligation of the property owner to provide that ordinance. They didn't in draft. So the township drafted the ordinance, adopted it, and then the property owner filed suit saying that they don't like the ordinance, but that was the settlement. The second thing that's pending is the property owner then filed an application, which isn't consistent with the settlement, to develop the flex buildings. And then the third matter is they've intervened in the court ordered of all municipalities to go over its affordable housing plan, and they've jumped in there. So with the direction of the governing body, we said to them, being the River Park, they have an application before the planning board, and we said, look, you're going to waste everybody's time. You know, we even filed a motion in court saying, why go forward with this application when, in fact, right now, you're suing us regarding the ordinance? So maybe the court should take over as opposed to put the planning board through this. So some cooler heads prevailed, and we urged them to put off the planning board application because we said, where are you going?
Who, the court or
no, River Park? Okay. We had filed a motion and they put the application off, not because it had any other meaning except it could very well be a waste of time. So they agreed to do that. We have to meet with a special master who's sort of a mediator but a planner with respect to all of the affordable housing. So they're in that case as well, so we've had to have a meeting with them, and there's been some discussions. But as the mayor said, years ago, they wanted 1,000 residential units, and that's what caused all the litigation. And that's certainly not anything that the governing body's going to entertain. But there hasn't been any other type of proposal by the governing body except, hey, we had a settlement which included the senior housing. Might be a good idea not to put the planning board through an application when you're in court and you're intervened in the other matter. So that was achieved. And that's really where we stand right now.
Okay.
We're obligated to meet with the special master and hear thoughts about the track. But the town's position right now has been, we have this settlement for all these years. and nothing's happened on the property. And that even goes back to the 1980s.
Is the special master a judicial or quasi-judicial?
Not really. It's a professional
mediator?
Planner that has no interest in anything but to try to facilitate, you know, any type of resolve that could come in the context of the bigger picture, the affordable housing litigation that every town. So every town has a special master. So
okay.
Because this is a large tract of land, they get to have a discussion with the governing body as well.
Given the reason for the postponement of the last meeting, is it likely that the November 4th meeting might be postponed for a similar reason, since nothing's been judicially resolved?
Yeah, I don't want to. I think there's a possibility, because there's going to be subsequent meetings with this special master. And again, at those meetings, we can't bind the governing body or anything like that,
right.
But just to get facts out.
Sure.
Because like at the first meeting, there was just a lot of discussion about the history.
Okay.
And I think the special master was like, you know, wow, this is a long time.
Yeah.
And a lot of effort's been made with various opportunities to develop. So that's where...
Last question on this subject. Did the 2004 settlement include a prohibition from having any egress for trucks and other traffic from the property onto Eden Lane? I thought I heard.
It did.
Tell me if I'm right. Rosin Road or Apollo Road with the options?
We have designs. Fred, I think I can take
them.
The answer to your question, Jim, is we don't want any commercial truck traffic on Eden Lane.
Opposite to Children's Park.
They have one driveway, as you might recall, all the way up by Central Park, the gated driveway up there, that if we use that exit at all, it would be a right-hand turn out of there. But we have been negotiating to get rights of way on Rosin Road. We have already talked to the M&E Railroad some time ago in an agreement with them on one of their sidings to cross the railroad tracks from her property onto Rosin Road. That's a good thing.
Wouldn't Apollo be a better solution given the wideness of the road?
That's also on the drawing board. So, you know, I have to be quite honest with you. I mean, I really don't want to consider...
I got you. I understand.
Any of these options beyond the...
I'm just thinking worst case scenario, protecting at least against the worst case scenario and then back our way up.
We do not intend to have Eden Lane impacted by...
Okay. I appreciate that. One quick update. Do you have any update on the quick check potential property at Jefferson Road and Route 10? Is there any news on that?
This one over here?
Yeah.
Council, we were having some discussions on some protocol tonight, but go ahead.
Right, and just some discussion, you know, outside of executive session, I spoke to their attorney about some possibilities, but whatever comes of it would be, you know, up for, you know, a public, you know, during the public meeting, you know, at a future public meeting and a resolution, if that were to happen, but they
at are... At a planning board or at a...
Town and a township hall, committee, township. You know,
okay.
But they, I think it's fair to say that at this point there's still technically an impasse where there's the risk that, you know, they're saying that they're not going forward, because I remember we had asked them where they are, so they have not gone forward with the initiation of the permitting and cleanup, you know, environmental requirements until they have this resolved, and at this point there's still no resolve. We've listened to them and their hearing and discussed various legal issues in executive session and some of the case law that's out there from the township's perspective. But as of right now, there's just been, you know, some discussion about what the ramifications would be.
Are most of the discussions centered around the hours of operation and the types of activity that could go on? Gas versus
they
convenience?
They are permitted to run other? The fueling operation, the gas operation. That we have no...
because that's on the main state road. That's on the state road, so we don't have control over that,
state
right?
Highway.
That's allowed.
Right.
So, and in, you know, in some of our opinions, that's the activity. 24/7 on the fueling operation, As council said, this is the impasse we're at with the C-store and in the discussions that we're having.
Okay. I appreciate the updates.
Thank you, Jim. Floor is still open. Anyone else would like to address the Township Committee at this time? Do so from the podium. That's number two, Barbara. Go ahead.
I know. Just a quick, you mentioned the COA housing. And just a quick update. I'm just curious on, I know you have a 1,000-unit mandate from this new COA. Can you speak to what
yeah,
the...
I'm somewhat glad you mentioned 1,000 units.
Yeah.
We all have 1,000 units. Council of Affordable Housing and the Builders Associations and everybody involved with that thing in their wonderful wisdom just assigned every town that was under COA 1,000 units. As John always says, the only reason we got 1,000 is they couldn't give us 2,000.
Hmm.
But you know what that is? That's just putting bullets in the chamber. So it says to Hanover, you know, either you deal with us in the court, or you deal with us, or you deal with the court on some number. This is their starting point. I think it's a fictitious number and one that this township should ignore. And we have complied with the council has submitted our objections to the court and in compliance with what Judge Hansberry wants. So now it's what's next steps with this, Fred?
It's to put together a plan that the township believes to be fair and reasonable, which is nowhere near what our experts will tell us, near 1,000 units. And I'm glad you mentioned it, too, because as the mayor said, that's just something that the township won't stand. But a lot of the builders have thrown that number out there, you know. But that's the next step.
I think you've said it well that, you know, it'll be there. It's never going to be enough. There's always going to be more coming. And that's why we're very hopeful that this process with the regional development, which is, you know, tied in with that initiative with the county. And the county, of course, did take a vote against the draft plan. That's a good step. That's a good thing. So I would urge the town to just say no. And I know that the League of Municipalities convention is this weekend. I would be very curious on what kind of discussion goes on there. There must be a bunch of municipalities that are rather ticked outside of Hanover Township. But I would tell you one of the really interesting things that they said at the meeting the other night about COA, because I think I mentioned it in my remarks, and they said, did you know that the new COA requirements are tied into the amount of jobs that you create
mm-hmm.
in your community? So I said, you mean because we were good enough, lucky enough, you know, smart enough to attract some more business interest to the old Lucent property that now we're getting whacked because
yeah,
of it.
New jobs. We fight them. It's got to be new jobs.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, I realize that it is. Well, maybe not compared to Lucent. I mean, I don't know how they figured that out. But I had never heard that there was any relationship, and maybe you know that.
Yeah. They've tied it to the economics of new jobs, et cetera. Bayer brought in their staff. Now, did they do some hiring? I suppose. But transitional hiring, whatever. But Wegman is potentially has 500 new jobs, so we'll all of that. I'm certain will be taken into consideration if we get these challenges. If the challenges get to the court, you know, and we'll have to see how the good Judge Hansberry rules on that.
Yeah, it seems patently unfair if a town is smart and does good planning to attract jobs to their community, they should get whacked.
Well, you know, the only problem with that is, and not to belabor it, but to give you an answer for the whole public, and that is, you know, townships have the right to zone, and we do
they
that.
Used to.
And each time we've zoned, we've tried to take into consideration what portions of our obligations we had. And as you know, at one point, we were down to only 9 COA units. So
right.
we did our part. The court says, you know what? We don't care about your zoning.
Yep.
Time's up.
Right. Oh, that's for me.
Yeah.
They're beeping me. The court says, we don't care about your zoning. So, in other words, you're not protected by the fact that you've rezoned Bayer OBRL or you've rezoned this piece of property for business retail. The court says, well, if that land can be cleaned up and that land is developable and that land can support housing, well, that's what they're going to do. So we're cognizant of that. So we're trying to work it, right, Fred?
Yes.
That's all we're doing.
I commend you, and I would encourage you to just continue to say no. It's ridiculous. If municipalities across the state got together and did that, maybe we could have a chance of winning this. It's
thank you, Barbara.
Yeah.
Doesn't that 1,000 units represent 5,000?
Which?
The 1,000 coal represent 5,000?
Yes, exactly, yeah. George. Yeah. Essentially, if yeah. we did what yeah. what the court is
inclusionary
mandating out to us, if we did this, we would essentially almost nearly double the amount of units in Hanover Township. This is like incomprehensible. So we need to work very hard.
There are not more than 1,000 units.
No. If we have 5,000, let's say, to make the numbers nice and round, if you have 5,000 dwelling units in Hanover Township today, and if we are to use our method of inclusionary affordable housing units, and if we wanted to build 1,000 affordable units with a 20% set aside, that's 5,000. 5,000 plus 5,000 equals 10,000. That's effectively doubling the amount of units. The idea of reality has been thrown out the window. So what
totally
our
ridiculous.
Responsibility is to educate, inform that this township has been complying with this since the 80s. This township has built out its affordable housing plan. This township was down to 9 units. So we are trying to really defend home rule because we believe we're on a very solid footing to do that.
Remember years ago when we went round one, coal was 22% set aside. What that meant was that if you built 100 units, 22 of them had to be low and moderate. Well, they've come back pretty much the same formula. They say it's inclusionary. So what John is saying is if you wanted to comply with this hypothetical 1,000 units at 20%, do the math. That's ridiculous. That's absolutely, you figure we have 3,200 heads of household in this town. I don't know how many residents that means, but you would literally double the population. We couldn't possibly suspend it. So Judge Hansberry, throw us out. That's it. Carol, how you doing?
Fine, thank you. Carol Femchenko, Malapartis, Fred Whippany, New Jersey. Going back to River Park.
Yeah.
You had mentioned that there were plans for diverting possibly truck traffic to Roslyn or Apollo.
Yeah.
Okay, thought came into my mind. Is that plan going to include a traffic light on Jefferson Road? If trucks or more car traffic
I think it has to,
is going to be dumped onto Jefferson Road?
There is in the plan when CAE went in. Remember when CAE is the aviation training facility?
Right.
Part of the planning board approval, John will correct me, but I'm pretty sure, at that time was if there was any greater impact to Apollo, that the traffic light would have to be installed. And so, as a matter of fact, if I'm not mistaken, and Jerry's here, I think we even retained some dollars somewhere where Sylvia would have to let me know on that. I don't know if we took some dollars back then, but we'd have to find out. Usually we do, but we'll see.
Would that apply to Roslyn Road as well, a traffic light? If you use Roslyn rather than Apollo?
Where the traffic light would go at this point, I don't think it's been defined.
I'm just trying to think of ways to alleviate the traffic on Jefferson
to help Malapartis
Road.
I'd like to get it to Route 10. I'd like to get it from that property to Route 10, and that's being explored as one of the options.
Well, that's nice.
Forget about Jefferson Road. Get it to go to Route 10. Right.
Yeah, I just thought that that would really help us.
Sure. Yeah.
And if you made the jug handle, if the jug handle around the church could possibly be made
the
two
jug
ways,
handle is not off the radar screen.
You know, make that two ways, that would alleviate all the traffic going to the corner.
I still find, having traveled that every day, as you know, and I do frequently, if we could turn right on that, right on red because of a jug handle, what an incredible reliever that would be to that. This morning, trying to get over here, 3 cars got through that light at 7:45. Three cars, Jerry. You know, the rest of it's all taking Route 10 traffic. It's ridiculous.
Okay.
But in any event.
Well, I'm glad to hear that that's hopefully on the plans.
Okay. We're going to keep a close eye on it. But right. I have a suspicion that River Park is going to be a long haul.
Okay. Thank you.
Floor is still open. Hearing none, seeing none, motion for close.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Mr. Administrator?
Thank you, Mayor. We have one item of communication. Is a letter dated October 26, 2015, addressed to Police Chief Stephen Gallagher. It's says, "Dear Chief Gallagher, please accept this letter of retirement from the position of sergeant. My last day at the Township of Hanover Police Department will be February 1st, 2016. It has been a pleasure. I thank you and Captain Waldron for all that you have done for me over the many years. Again, it has been a pleasure working as a part of your department. Best regards, Sergeant Martin Zubalinski." May we have a motion to accept the letter of retirement?
Second.
Mr. Coppola, seconded by Mr. Bruno. All in favor?
Aye.
So approved. We have the following departmental reports on file and available for public inspection. They include the report of all projects and activities undertaken by the Department of Public Works, Buildings and Grounds, and Park Maintenance during the month of October. The Township's Treasurer, Chief Municipal Finance Officer, has submitted his report on the summary of budget revenues as of the 9th of October. The 9th of November. We have the quarterly financial report submitted by the Treasurer of the Whippinong Library through October 2015. Finally, we have the construction official's report of all activities conducted during the month of October. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we continue with the approval of Township Committee minutes of October 22nd and the Bid Committee meeting of November 3rd. May we have a motion for approval?
So moved.
Second. Moved by Mr. Bruno, seconded by Mr. Gallagher. All in favor?
Aye.
So approved. Next item, ladies and gentlemen, is the introduction of Ordinance Number 31-15. As you may recall, following Hurricane Sandy, the Township Committee authorized an appropriation of $110,000 for the installation of a new natural gas emergency generator at the Public Works Department complex. We have now received notification from the Federal Office of Emergency Management that we will be receiving a grant in the amount of $75,000 to help offset a portion of that new gas generator. So this ordinance appropriates the sum of $75,000, so we can take that in as revenue. This is docketed as Ordinance 31-15. We will have the public hearing on the evening of December 10th at 8:30 p.m. here in the main meeting room. And at that time, any citizen wishing to be heard will be given the opportunity to comment. The ordinance and the notice of introduction will appear in full in the Daily Record in accordance with law. So at this time, may we have a motion to introduce Ordinance Number...
So moved.
Second. Motion.
Second.
On roll call, Mr. Gallagher.
Aye.
Mr. Faramasca.
Aye.
Mr. Bruno.
Aye.
Mr. Coppola.
Aye.
And Mr. Franciola.
Aye.
So introduced.
Yes, Mr. Giorgio, I'd like to introduce a land use ordinance tonight that the Planning Board has worked on based upon the direction of the Township Committee. This ordinance number is 32-2015, and it's a residence district called R10A, which is located on Whippany Road and Park Avenue that we've been highlighting for about a year now. And the modification to the existing R10A ordinance is as follows. Planning Board is recommending that we expand the potential uses in that zone from single-family detached homes to townhouse dwellings. This new...
No, not both, one or the other.
This new ordinance effectively would reduce the number of townhome units from 25, which was previously proposed, to 24. Impervious coverage would be limited to no greater than 38%, and building coverage would be limited to 21%. I think this is a much enhanced plan versus the cluster of the R10A homes. So I'm introducing
all these carriage homes.
Yes, these are carriage townhomes, George, that are age-targeted. They're not age-restricted, and they're age-targeted, meaning that the master bedroom in a majority of these homes will be located on the first floor, because that's what is preferred for people above the age of, let's say, 55-plus. So they will be targeted. There will be proper buffering, just as if there was an R10A. It will be an enhanced look for the township, and I think it is a much better plan than what previously was presented to us for the single-family homes.
The yard distances are considerably larger, and that was a big consideration for the township committee when it looked at it, and recommendation of going back to the planning board and telling the developer to scrap the original plan. The yard distances at one point were no more than 20 feet from the neighboring property line, and in particular Ms. DeCaro's lands. Not that she complained, but that's certainly not suitable. These yard distances would be nearly double that distance, and the distance from Whippany Road in would nearly triple what it was originally planned. So from the from the aesthetics and the yard distances alone, this is a vast improvement. So we think the quality will be there. So having said that, you introduce your motion.
John,
I just have a question for John. John, when we have the hearing on this, can you have photos prepared for us to share with Hanover Township's residents?
Mr. Gallagher, I think that's a very good idea. We can demonstrate the architecture, and we can get a better appreciation for what is actually being proposed with this ordinance. So I think it's a good idea.
And I would just like to say, too, that the architecture here is similar to Mendham Commons. If anybody's familiar with Mendham Commons or that style building, they're actually beautiful.
Probably closer to Vieira.
They're actually beautiful.
Gorgeous. And,
So we'll have those information at the end.
Okay, now, ladies and gentlemen, because this is a land use ordinance, it will be referred for recommendation to the planning board in accordance with the municipal land use law. And in order to give it the statutory time frame, the ordinance will not be considered for public hearing until the meeting of Monday evening, December 21st at 8:30 p.m. And at that time, any member of the public will be given an opportunity to be heard. And also, because this amends the regulations for the R10A zone district, we must provide written notification to all property owners within 200 feet of the proposed development.
Is that for the next meeting?
No, not this cannot be heard now until December 21st, which is the last meeting in December, and that's a Monday evening meeting. The ordinance and the notice of introduction will be published in full in the Daily Record in accordance with law. So at this time, may we have a motion for introduction?
So moved.
So moved
second.
By Mr. Faramasca, seconded by Mr. Bruno. On roll call, Mr. Gallagher.
Aye.
Mr. Faramasca.
Aye.
Mr. Bruno.
Aye.
Mr. Coppola.
Yes, aye.
And Mr. Franciola.
Aye.
So introduce, ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Coppola is just reminding me to remind everyone the next Township Committee right before the Thanksgiving holiday will be Monday, November the 23rd.
Mm-hmm.
As we continue, ladies and gentlemen, we have the consent agenda of resolutions A through I. And if there are any questions from members of the governing body concerning any of the resolutions, please just speak up.
Will they be approved?
Second.
We have a motion by Mr. Coppola, seconded by Mr. Faramasca. On roll call to approve the resolutions as a consent agenda, Mr. Gallagher.
Aye.
Mr. Faramasca.
Aye.
Mr. Bruno.
Aye.
Mr. Coppola.
Aye.
And Mr. Franciola.
Aye.
So, approved. Ladies and gentlemen, we have payment of bills, $7,200,628.66.
Motion to approve and pay the bills.
Motion by Mr.
Second.
Bruno, seconded by Mr. Gallagher. On roll call, Mr. Gallagher.
Aye.
Mr. Faramasca.
Aye.
Mr. Bruno.
Aye.
Mr. Coppola.
Aye.
And Mr. Franciola.
Aye.
And we have one raffle application also as a consent item. Raffle application 2885, the Morris County Sheriff's Crime Stoppers for a 50-50 on-premise at the Birchwood Manor. We have a motion for approval. So moved by Mr. Coppola.
Second.
Second by Mr. Gallagher. All in favor?
Aye.
So approved. Mr. Chairman, members of the Township Committee, that clears the agenda of the Business Administrator, Township Clerk, and I thank you.
Thank you, Joe. Appreciate it. Once again, gentlemen, I'd like to open the floor. Motion to open.
So moved.
Okay, thank all you. In favor?
Aye.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, once again, the floor is open. Anyone would like to address the Township Committee at this time can do so from the podium, giving us your name and address for the record.
Jim Neidhart again, Appleton Way, Whippany, New Jersey. As you know, when the R10A was originally approved, there were a lot of people in the town that weren't very happy with that. And
you're speaking of the Park Avenue, Whippany
Park
Road.
Park Avenue, Whippany Road.
Yeah, I don't think they fully understood the impacts of what was before them.
I don't think a lot of people were happy, to say the least.
Yeah.
And there was a lot of talk in town, negative talk. But I do have to commend both the Township Committee and the builder for working together after it was approved in order to come up with something that was better. And that was done, from my understanding, to suffice some of the concerns of the residents. And having had the opportunity to see the plans, both the old plans and the new proposed architectural drawings, I don't think you did it justice in terms of explaining what a great improvement it was.
Oh.
Having looked at what a lot of the concerns were by some of the more vocal residents about buffering and visibility from the street and cut-throughs and things like that, which mm-hmm. were valid concerns, and I understand you guys were picking between the lesser of many evils. Still, what was proposed and is being put before the committee now is a tremendous improvement in terms of buffering and visibility. Although these homes are absolutely beautiful by comparison to the block type style that was originally proposed and approved, yep. much improved, you're not going to see it from the road. There's going to be lots of trees and depth of foliage that is going to protect that. And also, my understanding is the road that is going to go through the property is much more curved than it was previously, mm-hmm. which will greatly discourage the cut-through. So
there's another aspect of that, Jim, is you describe it as a road. Township probably will not take it as a road because now it's a driveway. And it's no different than the driveway at Grande, which is a driveway system. So one of the big concerns was traffic, avoiding the traffic light at Whippany Road by cutting through here. Well, you're probably going to see, as a driveway, speed limits of the 10-mile-an-hour range, et cetera, or similar. So we think that's been responded to as well. But it's a far, far better plan.
So many aspects. I would suggest, since this was discussed at a meeting, that when you present the pictures, that you use the video here,
yeah.
so that you can show the before and the after, do the flip, before, after, mm-hmm. before, after. Only then do you really see the difference in the coverage, the total coverage that the buildings take. It is significantly less,
between
even though it's
the two.
Almost
yeah.
the same number of yeah. things. So I think that would be a yeah. great
there
opportunity.
Is, a rendering that shows before with an overlay of after, and
yep.
that really shows you the difference of how significantly more enclosed the carriage houses are that you probably won't even see them
yep.
off of the road.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else like to be heard at this time?
This is 3 hours for count.
Okay. I just ask about the MetLife development there that goes up that I drive by a lot, and I have to say, in all honesty, that I'm still kind of recovering from the removal of those beautiful trees, the sloping of that property, and that new building like right there. And I'm sure you're not done with it. It's also a much wider road, and I know that when that happens, that tends to increase the speed with which people travel a road. Witness coming out of Morristown, there, Morris Avenue, which they have such trouble with. They've had it for years. If you want a 25-mile-an-hour speed limit, you shouldn't have a four-lane road there. And I think about that when I look at the property there. I'm sure you're not done. I mean, obviously, they haven't even started the landscaping. But those big berms in front Are they staying? Can you describe to me what it's going to look like when it's done? Because I'm just...
They'll be landscaped, but John could probably answer.
The berms which were there will be totally redone. On top of those berms, there will be trees planted. So if you were sitting in the parking lot of OLM Chapel and you were looking dead on at the building, you'd see the top floor of the building. Everything else would be buffered. So there's going to be significant buffering. The setback, which according to the ordinance was 300 feet, the only modification to this was 25 feet. In order for them to get that 25 feet, they needed to agree to us that they were going to shield it properly, because we did not want to have a monstrous building sitting onto Route 10.
Yeah, okay, that's what you kind of see, but it looks like that big berm is designed to hide it, but it's really a big berm. So you're saying it's going to be lower?
It's going to be landscaped. It's going to be beautifully landscaped. There's illustrations.
Is it going to be that high?
Yes.
Okay.
With trees on top.
With trees on top of it. So again, if you were sitting in the parking lot of OLM's Chapel and you were looking at it, you'll see the top floor of the building.
Yeah, it's just rather naked now. I mean, I realize that it's a new build. I mean, obviously they're not finished, et cetera, but it looks different than it used to.
And regarding the speed limit issue, Mr. Gallagher, I know Mr. Coppola can speak to you. They're working on trying to rationalize the speed limit of Whippany Road from Parsippany all the way to Park Avenue.
The one thing I'll tell you about Whippany Road, and we discovered this with our subcommittee, is from Park Avenue to Route 10, the speed limit actually changes 7 times.
Wow.
But one of them is a recommended speed change. So we have a plan, and it's back in motion to make that consistent. And we also want to look at the fact that we have 3 schools in a close proximity to one another: OLM, Whippany Park High School, and Salem Drive. So we're looking at that together. And the one other thing I learned in the last 21 months working with this committee, with Committeeman Coppola, is the more lanes is in response to congestion. And around schools sometimes we hear comments about speeding. Well, the speeding is for the people that are late. Typically our biggest problems around the schools is congestion. So with the 4 lanes, I think it'll alleviate a lot of congestion. And I think
I'm not sure what you mean by 4 lanes. It was 4 lanes. It is 4 lanes.
It was 2, and now it's
going
to
3 going.
It was 3, and now it's going to be.
It'll be 3 lanes going north from Eden Lane.
It's a D cell and an X cell lane.
Right. Yeah, I think that's going to be a big.
Oh, you mean it was 4 lanes in front of Lucent?
Okay. There'll be a total of 5 lanes.
Right. Okay. Right. You're adding a lane. Yeah, and then one's a turn lane or something, I guess,
right.
Too. So are there 5 lanes plus a turn lane? Is that
no,
what it is?
It'll be the fifth lane added will be a deacceleration lane to enter into that campus.
Okay.
XL, okay. DCL, yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, anyone else at this time? Hearing none? Seeing
motion
none?
To close.
Motion to close.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, members of the committee, any comment at this point?
Just one note from recreation. There are tennis courts at the Upper Malapartis Park. I don't know how many residents ever actually utilize those. It's probably a facility that's underutilized. But we're teaming up with our high school students, some engineering students or aspiring engineering students, some science students, who are going to take on a project of making recommendations as to how better perhaps to utilize lights, low impact, maybe some solar energy if applicable, and kind of revitalize that park. So point being, we're working with some local students, high school students, aspiring engineers who want to help make the town a better place, and this is the first project we're undertaking. So we're looking forward to the recommendations and happy to be working together with some of the local students in the community.
Thank you. Right, George?
Yeah, Landmark had their concert last month over at the Memorial Junior School. Even with the bad weather, we did have a nice turnout. And it really was a great concert, and it dealt with the history of Hanover and the tricentennial. Speaking of that, there is a forum on the 21st of this month over at the Memorial Junior School from 9 o'clock to 2. the public is invited. Here again, it's on the honor awards, the tricentennial, and a lot of things that are history of Hanover Township. And lastly, as you go through the town, you'll see a lot of construction going on, a lot of road work, police officers all over. I would, you know, the committee would ask that everyone to please be patient, okay? Within a month or so, most of the construction is going to be completed. Whitney Road should be done no later than January 1st. They're doing very good headway. We're working on East Lane from Boulevard to Jefferson Road. As you can see, there'll be sidewalks again on both sides of that street. We just paved Mount Pleasant and Legion Place, and they're just doing a lot of work, a lot of traffic getting blocked here and there. But all the committee asks is everyone to please be patient. Shortly it'll be completed, and we'll get on to the next roads that need to be done.
Thank you. John?
Just a couple quick ones. I wanted to also acknowledge our vets. My father was a captain in the Army. My father-in-law was in the Korean War when he was 17 years old. My first exposure to this was in fourth grade. We accompanied, me and my two brothers, my mom's choir at Kessler Institute, and at that point I had the first real look at the sacrifice that these men and women made for us. When I was 17 years old, my biggest concern was having enough money to chip in my portion of the shore house that me and all my friends got. So I understand and respect the sacrifice that they made for us, that, like Ron said, that we can be here tonight. And I also want to thank Committeeman Coppola, because I know that he made 20 jumps. And when I'm on my roof blowing out my gutters, my wife comes out and says, I don't want you up there, and I have a ranch. So, George, I appreciate everything you did. I appreciate everything all of these guys did. And I think that even when I was 18 years old, I really did believe I was a tough guy. And when I had to fill out my secrets, my special, what was it called, Joe? George? The when you enlist for selective service, I was petrified. And I asked both my parents, if they call me, do I have to go? And although I was lifting weights and thought I had big biceps, I was petrified. So, George, I really respect what you and all of these guys did. Thank you very much. And I just want to say one more thing about the DPW. This, for some reason this year, many of our trees are losing their leaves late. And although the guys are out 7 days a week with their machines, there's a lot of leaves and a lot of leaf piles in the street. So please be careful. We have one lane. Sometimes there's two cars that want to get by, and there might be a kid on a bike, and it gets dark early now. So the guys are out there 7 days a week working hard. Just please take a few extra minutes and be careful, because some of the roads are very narrow. That's it, Mayor.
Thank you, Ted. John?
Yeah, Mayor. Operation Pave Our Roads is well underway. And Township Committee has pulled forward $1 million in capital improvement funds to do that. And this week, Mr. Coppola touched on some of this, but I just want to make sure it's all clear. Whippany Road, we're making excellent progress. So we feel really good about the schedule and hitting that schedule.
First of the year, we should be out of there.
Yeah. Eden Lane is underway. Eden Lane, for those of us who live in Hanover Township, know that that's a major artery for our residents. That's how we go from one side to the other in this township. And the good news is, we originally were planning on paving from Boulevard to Jefferson. We're now going to pave from Boulevard to Whippany Road. So the entire stretch of Whippany of Eden Lane will be done. Cedar Knolls Road was completed. Mount Pleasant Avenue was completed. Legion Place was completed. From an environmental standpoint, the Green Team has won New Jersey State Bronze Certification for its efforts. And congratulations to the members of the Green Team. They worked very hard at that. And last Saturday, we ran a program, the Green Team, called Free Community Shred Day, in conjunction with Employment Horizons. And it was a great success. Over 50 residents came out, and over a half ton of confidential information was destroyed in their presence at no cost to them. So it worked out very well, and we thank those who came out to do it, and the Green Team for coordinating it. Mayor, that concludes my report.
Great. Thank you, gentlemen. You're really working well. Just a quick little announcement. The second meeting of the, what we'll call the Stony Brook Community Farm will be held on the 20th of November. And that will be part of a steering committee. We're well on our way. We're working with engineering to define the limits of the farm itself. It's going to be off of Fannick Road, but we're calling it the Stony Brook Farm. You're going to access it by parking in the soccer lane in the back, and then you can come forward to there. But we've got a lot of work ahead of us, but we've got the right people on board, some people from the county, some people from the Interfaith Food Pantry, and we're off to a good start. And I'll keep you posted on that. I think it's going to be pretty exciting, something in the neighborhood of 150 to 160 farm plots that we'll have available for the community, with obviously the principal purpose is to get food to the pantry for those 5,000 families now in the county of Morris, which is shocking, who still need food and assistance these days. Finally, and lastly, and I'd like to address the community on one matter. Been getting a great deal of phone calls, probably deservedly so. You got a letter from our township over my signature regarding snow removal for the sidewalks. Some have interpreted the letter as very disciplinary in nature. I assure you it was only a reminder to all of the residents in our town to do what is responsibly correct, and that is after a snowstorm make arrangements to have your sidewalks cleared, and particularly those sidewalks in school areas where children have to get access to the buses. Township's part of the problem. We have to look at the manner in which we plow the streets and where we pile snow up at the intersections. But having said that, again, I apologize if anyone is offended by the letter, but please take note of it and try to adhere to it. I know many of us go away for the winters, God bless you. There's snowbirds that get down there to Florida and leave the homes and their sidewalks. Give some thought to some arrangements as to how you would like the sidewalks cleared. And if you're handicapped in any way or unable to do the sidewalks, and we know that, we'll try to work with you to make some arrangements to have the sidewalk cleared. We're not out to cause anybody any additional hardship, especially those of us that are not prepared to shovel sidewalks. So having said that, again, on behalf of the township, please take the letter on the basis of it informing you about the sidewalks. Thank you. Anything else from the committee? None?
Motion to close.
Motion to
so
adjourn.
Moved.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Adjourn.
Okay. Good job, Mr. Mayor.
Yeah, 9-3.
Yeah, then we should get that little note out here. Good stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah. The R10A.